Welcome back. In the last few lectures, we given an English language passage, we tried to identify the argument. So we said that whenever there is a premise and conclusion indicator, then we said that, you know, there seems to be some kind of argument present in a English language passage, or maybe while you are reading a textbook, scientific textbook, etc., you know, or maybe a newspaper or something else. So how to identify an argument was the first important task for us. Then we started recognizing the once we started recognizing the argument, and we distinguished it from non-arguments in a sense that reports, piece of advice, suggestions, warnings, etc., and all these things comes under non-arguments in a sense that they are all non-inferential passages, and all. So there is no inferential claim involved in those kinds of passages and all, that's why that passage doesn't contain any argument. So once we recognize the argument and all, so then the next question comes to us is what kind of argument it is. So there are two kinds of argument which we usually come across in introductory logic course, or in logic at least. Two kinds of arguments which we come across. One is inductive argument, another one is deductive argument, based on how the conclusion follows from the premises. We are saying that it is a deductive argument or it is an inductive argument and all. If the conclusion necessarily follows from the premises, then it is called as a kind of deductive argument. If the conclusion probably follows from the premises, then it is called as an inductive argument. And also we said that in the case of deductive argument, there is no new information in the conclusion which is not there in the premises. Whatever is there in the premises, we are trying to make it explicit in the conclusion, whereas in the case of inductive arguments, the conclusion goes beyond what is stated in the premises. So inductive arguments are in general, they are defeasible in nature. That means addition of new information might invalidate the old conclusions that you have drawn earlier. In the case of deductive arguments, it is called as monotonic, it is not non-defeasible. So they are even if you add more information and all, your old conclusion will still follow. So this is what we have done so far. So now once we recognize the arguments and identified that this is an inductive argument and this is a deductive argument, then the next question comes to us is what we mean by validity of deductive arguments and what we mean by the strength of a given inductive argument. In this class, what I am going to talk about are these things. So first I will talk about what we mean by truth and its relationship with the validity, and I will consider a few examples. And then it is not enough that the arguments are valid, and then it has to be one extra condition we will impose, that is what we call it as soundness. So this is the case for the deductive arguments. A deductive argument can be valid or invalid. A valid deductive argument can be sound or unsound. In the case of inductive arguments, you can only talk about the strength of the argument. So you can say that a given inductive argument is either weak or strong. If it is a strong inductive argument, the next question comes to us is whether it is a cogent or uncogent argument. A cogent inductive argument is a one in which it has probably true premises and all. Whereas an uncogent argument is a one in which at least it has one false premise. So these are the things which we will be explaining in detail, and there is one important method which is a kind of commonsensical method. It is not a formal method, etc., and all. We will be using other formal decision procedures little bit later, but since we are considering everything from the scratch, the basic concepts, so we will be talking about a specific method which is very interesting and all. So that method is called as counterexample method. If time permits, we'll go into the details of this one. So now the most important thing which we'll be asking ourselves is what we mean by truth. So this is the most difficult question to answer. It's a $1 million kind of question. It's not easy to come up with an answer. So but as far as possible, we are trying to define what we truth, or at least the definition of truth that seems to be acceptable to us for some time being. So there are, we are all thinking beings, we think a lot, so there are some thoughts, and then the thoughts corresponding to some kind of reality, reality of the world or external world, etc. and all. When thoughts refer to some kind of object that exists actually in the world, it's a mapping between your thought and the actual object which is existing in the world, then we say that there is a correspondence between whatever you think and then whatever actually exists there. Suppose if I show something that, you know, for example, if I say that this is a pen, then this corresponds to one of the objects that exist right in front of me, so that's why that statement is true. Suppose if I say that this is a donkey, and then no one will be in a position to believe that this is a donkey and all. It's not referring to the actual facts, etc., that exist in the world and all. So there are various theories of truth, which I'm not going into the details of these things. So there are debates between these theories of truth and all, but the most widely used, or you can say default theory of truth, is the correspondence theory of truth. So what is this correspondence theory of truth? I am not going to the details of these things, but I will briefly mention that, you know, here are three theories of truth which we commonly use. So mostly we will be using correspondence and coherence theory of truth. There is another theory of truth which is due to pragmatists, that is pragmatic theory of truth, which I will talk about a little bit later. So the correspondence theory of truth is as follows. So according to the correspondence theory, a claim, that means it can be a conclusion, or we will be claiming lots of things and all. So a claim is considered to be true, mostly it is a conclusion in an argument, if it corresponds to what it is so, that means it refers to some kind of facts, reality, etc. and all. If it is not referring to the facts of matter or the reality that exists in the world, etc. and all, the sentence is false and all. So if it does not correspond to what it is so, then that is considered to be a false statement and all. Suppose if I say that this is a cat, then it is not referring to the cat and all, so it is referring to some kind of pen, etc. So if I say that this is a pen, then this is corresponding to the actual pen that exists in the world and all, so it corresponds to the actual world that exists in the world and all. So that is why the sentence is true. Suppose if I say that this is a cat or donkey or something else, then that particular kind of statement is false and all. It is as simple as that. There should be some kind of correspondence with the reality or actual matters of fact that we commonly encounter in day to day discourse. So for example, if you say snow is white, just in case snow is actually white and all. Suppose if snow is black in color, then whatever you are saying is considered to be false and all. Actually that is not the case, so that is why it is false and all. It is as simple as that, and most of the scientists, etc., they are all comfortable with this kind of theory of truth. So we are not going into the depth of these theories, to what extent these theories works, etc. and all. At this moment we are just briefly mentioning what we mean by truth and all. So since truth has this connection to the validity, so that is why we need to talk about some minimal kind of things about the truth and all. So we will gradually discuss in greater detail when we talk about truth in propositional logic and truth in predicate logic, etc. and all. So there is another theory of truth which is slightly different from the correspondence theory of truth. Correspondence theory of truth tells us that, you know, there should be some correspondence between whatever you are saying and the actual world, actual object that exists in the world. So coherence theory of truth, according to the coherence theory of truth, a statement is true if it is logically consistent with other beliefs that are already held to be true enough. We are all having some kind of belief system, we accept so many beliefs to be true, etc. and all. So something is logically consistent with our existence beliefs and all, then that particular kind of belief is coherent with the beliefs that you already have and all at this moment. So a belief is false if it is inconsistent or contradicts with other beliefs that are held to be true earlier. So for example, if you say that we don't believe that dinosaurs currently exist because they all got extinct long back, some meteorite fell on earth and all dinosaurs got extinct, as that is what we know, actual matter of fact is that. So we don't believe that dinosaurs currently exist primarily because it contradicts so many of our other scientific beliefs and all. So we know that it got extinct, etc. and all. So it is inconsistent with what we believe at this point of time. So any belief which is inconsistent with the existence, the belief is what we call it as incoherent and all. So what is important here is that there should not be any, need not be any correspondence between whatever you think and the actual actual object that exists in the world and all, but here there should be we should maintain some kind of logical consistency and all. So if you believe P or not P, then the other belief such as for example, if you come across any belief such as P and not P, which is a contradiction and which goes against P or not P and all, so this is not logically consistent with that particular kind of thing, so it is not coherent with that particular kind of thing. So this is what we mean by coherence theory of truth, and it has its own problems which I am not going into the details of that one. So there are many beliefs, there are some issues with respect to coherence theory of truth which I am not going into the details of that particular kind of thing. So there is another kind of theory of truth which is called as pragmatic theory of truth, which is due to famous American philosopher William James, So according to the pragmatic theory of truth, any statement, a statement is a sentence which is, which can be spoken as either true or false. So that statement is true if it allows you to interact effectively and efficiently with your external world and all, cosmos, that's what we are calling it as. So according to this, the less true a belief is, the less it facilitates the kind of interaction that we are talking about. So that means a belief is false if it is, it facilitates no possible interaction and all, in that case it is false and all. If it facilitates interaction, then it is considered to be true. This is a little bit difficult and abstract to abstract concept to understand and all. So there are, for example, to put it in simple terms, for example, if you say that my belief that inanimate objects, objects doesn't have any life etc and all, for example a pen which is in front of me, do not spontaneously get up and move about etc and all, we don't believe such kind of thing to be true and all, because it makes my world more predictable and thus easier to live in. So my belief that inanimate objects do not spontaneously get up and move about is true because it makes my world more predictable and thus easier to live in and all. We believe that the world behaves in a certain way and all, we don't expect that all of a sudden rocks will fly and or rocks will float on water, pigs will fly etc and all, because that doesn't work in the universe, behaves in such a way that it doesn't work and all. So what matters here, matters the most here is what works and all, what works at the end of the day is what matters the most in the case of pragmatic theory of truth. So the belief that inanimate objects all of a sudden starts flying etc will not work and all, so it goes against the principles of nature etc. So the pragmatic theory of truth invites, the one problem of this one is that it invites the notion that there are degrees of truth and all, since it is it involves some kind of degrees of truth for the statements and all, that means it allows for, let us say, 70% true, 50% true etc and all, the propositions of statements. So some beliefs might be in that sense effective than the others, and thus involves us to reject one of the important fundamental laws of logic, that is law of non-contradiction. Law of non-contradiction says that a statement cannot be both true and both false and all, but if you allow for the degrees of truth, then you can very well say that a sentence can be true, a sentence can be false as well. For example, a sentence is 0.5 true and the other sentence is 0.5 false etc. So a sentence can be both true and both false as well. So this leads to the rejection of the law of non-contradiction. Then if you reject the law of non-contradiction, we will be doing some different kinds of logic. Initially we said that the logics that we will be following in this course will obey, perfectly obey the three fundamental laws of logic. They are law of identity, law of which says that P is P, law of excluded middle which says that P are not P, and the law of non-contradiction, a statement cannot be both true and both false simultaneously at the same time. So if you allow for pragmatic theory of truth, then we need to get away from law of non-contradiction etc and all. So there are some other issues with respect to pragmatic theory of truth which I am not going into the details of this one. but mostly the default theory of truth is the correspondence theory of truth. At this moment what we need to take into consideration is that suppose if I say that this is a pen, that means it's actually referring to the actual pen, and that's why the sentence is true. You know, suppose if I say that this is a donkey, then it's not referring to the donkey, it is referring to actually to the pen, so that's why the sentence is false. For example, if I say that there are only two doors in this room and all, actually there is only one door here in this room, so that's why the statement is false. So it's as simple as that one. So now coming to the concept of validity. So validity is the most important, the fundamental concept that one needs to learn in any logic course. Validity talks about what follows from what. So after all, the one of the important tasks of logic is to understand what follows from what. And all, you have some set of statements and all, those statements are leading to another set of statements which we call it as claims. So the word valid is often used to simply indicate one's overall approval of an argument, something which you accept it to be the final kind of point or something, conclusion, etc. That is considered as you reach to some kind of agreement and all, then that is called as a validity. And all, in general day to day discourse, that is what we mean by validity. And all, for example, two friends are accepting on certain things, they reach some kind of agreement and they will start believing that kind of thing. And all. But in logic in particular, an argument is valid if it is impossible for the conclusion to be false given the premises are true. And all. So an argument is valid if it would be contradictory or impossible to have all the premises true and the conclusion false. An invalid argument is the one in which it is not necessary that if the premises are true the conclusion can be true and all. So what is the most important thing which we need to know is that deductive arguments are truth preserving kind of arguments and all. So that means if you assume the premises to be true, there is no way in which you can make your conclusion false and all. So if the premises are true, then that guarantees that your conclusion is also true and all. So the most important thing which is important in case of validity is that we need to rule out the possibility that you have true premises and a false conclusion and all. You can very well have this particular kind of thing that one of the premises can be false, but yet you can have a true conclusion, it also works and all. Or both premises can be false but still the conclusion is true, that also seems to be okay for us. And in the same way, one of the premises is true, another premise is false, and the conclusion is true or false, etc., then also it is acceptable to us. But what you need to rule out completely is that if the premises are true, the conclusion cannot be false. So if that is the case, then the argument is called as valid, otherwise the argument is invalid. So we need to ensure that if you have two premises and you cannot have false conclusion and all. So that is what we need to keep it in mind. For example, if you say, if you argue in this way, if you overslept you will be late to the class, and of course you are not late to the class, that means you didn't oversleep, that's why you could come to the class on in time. So this argument is an example of modus tollens. The first one can be represented as A implies B and not B, second one is represented as not B, so that's why it is not A and all. So this argument is a valid argument in a sense that even if you try to construct a counter example in a sense that you have true premises and you try to come up with a counter example and all, like false conclusion, so then you will yourself will come to know that it's difficult to, that is in fact it is impossible to construct a counter example in which the premises are true and the conclusion is false and all. So for constructing a counter example, what you need to do is first you need to talk about the form of this argumentation. A, this is the first one is A implies B, and the second one is not B, and then this is what is the case. If you overslept, then you will be late to the class. You are not late to the class, that means you did not oversleep and all. So that is what seems to be the case and all. This is a valid form and this is a valid argument. Suppose if you have used in this sense the same thing, A implies B, and then if you say not A and then you infer not B, then this argument is invalid, because you can come up with an instance where you can make both these premises true and the conclusion false. But in this case it is it's impossible to construct a counter example. What we mean by constructing a counter example, so there are certain things which we obviously know these things to be true, or obviously you know that there are certain things which are false. For example, if you say all cats are mammals, that is accepted to be true for us. There are obvious things which we know that they are true. Or if you say all cats are fish, then that argument, that statement is false. Or if you say that all cats have five legs, etc., for example, for the sake of fun you can take this into consideration, the statement is false. So like that you take some true statements and all, forget about what A, B tells us and all, once you extract it into some kind of form and all, so then you substitute for A anything and all, cats, dogs, anything and all, or donkeys or anything, and then see whether you could come up with a counter example and all. Counter example in a sense that what needs to be ruled out, we have true premises and a false conclusion, this has to be ruled out and all. Suppose if you can cook up a situation where A implies B is the case, and then this is also true, this is also true, then the conclusion is false and all, you could come up with such kind of example, then this argument is obviously invalid. That means you have come up with a counter example. Coming up with a counter example means it is not necessary that the conclusion follows from the premises and all. That means you have shown with an example that you have a true premises and you have a false conclusion and all. So this is what needs to be ruled out and all. So to put in simple terms, these are your premises and this is your conclusion. So if your premises are true and the conclusion is true, there is no problem and all. So if the premises are true and the conclusion is false, then this is validity and all. These are your premises and this is your conclusion, and then we are talking about validity and all. So your conclusion is true, then let us talk about this question mark a little bit later. So when you have true premises and a false conclusion, definitely the argument is invalid. So when you have true premises and a false conclusion, the argument is clearly invalid. But there are three other situations and all where your premises can be true, conclusion can be true, but validity it may be valid or it may be invalid. So you can have both premises false and yet you can have a valid argument, or you can have false premises and true conclusion, but it can be valid, it can be a valid argument and all. So what I am trying to say is that out of the four possibilities that I have discussed, they are your conclusion can both be true, and the conclusion your premises can both be true, the conclusion can also be true, and that seems to be a valid argument, no problem for that. You can come up with valid arguments in that way, or you can also come up with true premises, true premises, and this needs to be ruled out and all. This is what is the most important thing. If you can come across with true premises and a false conclusion, the argument is clearly invalid, then in all other cases it is considered as a valid argument. You should ensure that you eliminate this particular kind of case. This is the decisive factor for knowing that the argument is invalid. You come across with a true premise and a false conclusion, obviously the argument is invalid. So then the other question comes to us is what about these other three cases and all. So in that case the question mark indicates that it may be valid argument, but you can talk about the other features such as soundness, etc. So a valid argument which consists of true premises is called as a sound argument, which will gradually enter into the details of it. So in the first example, if you overslept, then you will be late to the PHI 142 class, and you aren't late, so that's why you didn't oversleep. That seems to be a valid form, it's a valid argument. So another important thing which you need to note is this, that in saying that you didn't oversleep based on all these assumptions and all, first assumption which are considered to be true, we implicitly assume that there is no shift in the meaning or reference of the terms that you have used. Hence we must use overslept, late, the terms which are used here, and you, etc. and all, in the same way throughout this argument and all. So in the case of deductive argument, it is taken for granted that there is no shift in the meaning of the words that you have used in the argument and all. For example, if you say this room is made up of atoms, atoms are invisible, so that means this room is invisible and all. In that case, atoms, the word atoms is used in two different senses and all. There is a shift in meaning from first premise to the second premise, so that is not allowed in the case of deductive arguments and all. So it is taken for granted that there is no shift in the meaning of the words that you have used in the argument. So another important thing which you need to note is that for validity, things need not have to exist actually in the world and all. You can argue in this way that all squares are circles and all circles are parallelograms. So you can say that all squares are parallelograms, you know. All squares are parallelograms, that is the conclusion here. That is obviously true and all, but other way around is not the case. All parallelograms are not squares, you know. So the conclusion is true, but you observe that it has false premises and all. So this falls under this particular kind of category. So all circles are squares, that is false statement. All circles are squares, all squares are circles, that is obviously false. All circles are parallelograms, that is also considered to be false. So but it is considered to be a valid argument. For the sake of assumption, you can take some of the premises to be true, and you have to see whether the conclusion is false or not. If the conclusion is false, then the argument is invalid. But in this case, the conclusion is obviously true and all. So in a way, it is preserving the truth and all, in the sense that you assumed that all squares are circles is true. So this is only for our assumption. Actually, we know that it goes against the principles of mathematics that you know, a square cannot be a circle, and all. It's counterintuitive to us. So, but what we have seen here in this case, in this situation, is that you have false premises, but still you have a true conclusion. But yet the argument is valid, and all. But it is impossible for us to come up with an argument in which you have true premises and obviously false conclusion. And all. So that seems to be ruled out, and all. So this kind of argument, it is an invalid kind of argument. You can come up with any counter example in which you can show that these two are true, then you can show that this conclusion, this is false. For example, if you say if it rains then the grass is wet, it did not rain, the grass is not wet and all. Of course it did not rain and all, but the grass can still be wet and all in several different ways. For example, a sprinkler might be on, or maybe somebody poured some water there, etc. So that means you could come up with an instance where you would come up with a counter example in which you have true premises and a false conclusion. So these are other examples which you commonly come across to strengthen our point that you cannot come across. It is very difficult to cook up an example where you have true premises and a false conclusion for a valid kind of argument, but yet you can say that it is a valid argument. So that argument has to be invalid and all. Suppose if you say if you are in Kanpur, you are obviously in Uttar Pradesh, because Kanpur is a part of Uttar Pradesh. Of course if you are not in Uttar Pradesh, then you should not be in Kanpur and all. So it is pretty straightforward thing and all. So you can ask, suppose I don't know anything about Kanpur or Uttar Pradesh or anything and all, how do we know that this argument is valid or invalid? So just transform this thing into an appropriate form. So this is what you come across. If you are in Kanpur, you are in Uttar Pradesh, you are not in Uttar Pradesh, then that means you are also not in Kanpur, you are somewhere else in India. So this seems to be the case, since a valid form, obviously this is a valid kind of argument. The next one is the one which we already discussed in greater detail. All squares are circles, all circles are squares, so that is why all squares are parallelograms. So you have false premises but you have a true conclusion and all, so that is also permitted, it is also a valid kind of perfectly valid kind of argument. But you might ask, how suppose if I accept these particular kinds of things, I mean does it make any sense to us or not? So for that you need to invoke another kind of property, it is give emphasis on some of the extra features of logic, that is the soundness and all. If you incorporate soundness into consideration, then we can rule out this particular kind of argument by saying that this argument is not sound. It is not sound in the sense that one of the premises is false and all. Of course in this case both premises are false, so obviously it is an unsound kind of argument. So there are some arguments in which I told in the last few classes that there is no way in which you can analyze that these arguments are valid or invalid and all, unless until you, there seems to be some mistakes in this argument and all, but it is very difficult to recognize it unless until you analyze the content carefully and all. So the argument goes like this: happiness is end of life, that is what we are trying to achieve, so everyone will be striving for happiness at least at the end of the day or maybe end of his life etc, and we know that end of life is obviously death etc, and therefore if you say that happiness is death, then nobody will be in a position to believe that this follows from the those two things, because in this argument what we have done is happiness, end of life is used in two different senses and all. So one is for achieving something, that is the main purpose which is used, happiness, and then the second one it is used in a different sense, that is end of life, in end of breath etc and all, that leads to death and all. So there is a shift in the meaning of the word or phrase that you use, that is the end of life is used in two different senses, so that is why this argument has some kind of mistake. When we talk about fallacies then we will talk about these kinds of arguments and all. Otherwise at the first instance if you observe these kinds of argument, it looks as if that they are valid arguments and all, like A implies B, B implies C, and A implies C is the case and all. So what is the connection between validity and true premises and all, which we already discussed in greater detail. There are four cases which I mentioned, so the only thing which should focus your attention is on this thing: your premises are true and the conclusion is false, then obviously the argument is invalid and all. That is the second case which we have shown it on the board and all. In all other cases the argument can still be valid and all. So we can rightly conclude that an argument is valid simply on the grounds that your premises are all true. We cannot guarantee that particular kind of thing and all. You can have true premises but still your argument may be invalid and all. Let us consider a simple example like this. Some Indians are women, suppose if you say that there is a case, you say some all not all will can be women and all, obviously some Indians are women. Let us say for a famous Bollywood actor Hrithik Roshan is an Indian, so therefore Hrithik Roshan is a woman, for example. If you say that particular kind of thing, then this argument is obviously invalid and all, because it may be the case that Hrithik Roshan is a man rather than a woman and all. The first premise says that only some Indians are women and all, but if you replace this argument in a different way, for example all Indian are women and all, which goes beyond our belief that you know it can be the case and all, but hypothetically you imagine a situation in which only people you will come across are women in India, the imaginary situation is assumed to be true and all, then Hrithik Roshan is an Indian, then in that case the first sentence which we have used, all Indians are women, which has no exception and all, that means there is no case in which you know somebody is a woman and all, so there are no exceptions for that universal generalization. In that case Hrithik Roshan has to be a woman, so but in this case some Indians are women, Hrithik Roshan is an Indian, both are true but still the argument is invalid and all. So we cannot judge only with the help of true premises and all that you know the argument is valid and all, but here is an instance you have true premises but still you have an invalid kind of argument and all. So but validity preserves the degrees, preserves the truth and all, so the truth preserving kind of thing. Suppose if you assume these two arguments to be true, the conclusion cannot be false and all. So in the first case some Indians are women, I mean some Indians are not women is also the true and all, which we have not taken into consideration here in this particular kind of argument. Some X or Y means some Y's are X also, so that is same as that particular kind of thing. Some X are not Y also, okay. So the other instance is this, that if you have true premises and a true conclusion but still the argument may be invalid. Some Indians work in movie industry, for example Aishwarya Rai is an Indian, again hence Aishwarya Rai works in movie industry and all. So the premise says that only some Indians are movie industry and all, Aishwarya Rai is an Indian, so obviously the second premise you cannot make it false and all. So the only way in which Aishwarya Rai works in the movie industry, just because she is an Indian, that doesn't seem to follow from this thing. All are true, but yet the argument seems to be not acceptable to us. If you had said that all Indians work in the movie industry, then the Aishwarya Rai is an Indian, then it might be the case that Aishwarya Rai has to work in the movie industry and all. But here it says that some Indians work in movie industry and all. Only some, it says about some and all. Some doesn't work in the movie industry and all. What happens if Aishwarya Rai is an Indian but still she does not come under the category of some Indians who doesn't work in the movie industry? In that case you could come up with a counter example in which your true premises and a false conclusion, Aishwarya Rai doesn't work in the movie industry. So what is important in all these examples, from all these examples, is that validity is what we is the one which we use to preserve the truth. And if you start with the truth and reason in a valid fashion, that means if your form so valid, then we will always end up with truth and all. Your true premises and you will not end up with a false conclusion. So that is what is the thing which we need to take into consideration. The next important feature which we will be knowing in greater detail is that it is not enough that your arguments are valid, but it has to be sound enough and all. So what is this extra feature that we are trying to add for a argument, for an argument? So an argument is sound if it is valid. First of all, it has to be valid and all, that means the conclusion necessarily follows from the premises, and the extra thing which it has to be, the extra feature that it has, it should have, is that it should have one of the premises to be true also. Not one of the premises, every premise has to be true and all. It so happens that your argument, the argument is valid but it has true premises as well. So how do we know that these premises are true or false, etc. and all? Again, you know, it's not the job of a logician to look into or verify the facts, etc. and all. It is the job of someone else and all. Maybe scientists might verify these facts to be true, etc. and all. So then, based on the evidence that you got, a scientist have verified it, and then two statements you could come up with, and how it is leading to the other statement and all, is the one which you are trying to talk about. So now, if you want to know that the argument is sound, then it has to be valid. That means it is impossible for the conclusion to be false given the premises which you are accepting it to be true. That is the first thing, that is a valid kind of argument. And the second thing which you need to see is that whether all the premises are actually true or not. So again, you can say how do we know that the thing is true and all? We use the default theory of truth which we have discussed in the beginning of this class, that you know a sentence is true which if it is corresponding to the actual world, corresponding to the object in the actual world which exists. So we try to show that either that one of the premises is false or that the conclusion doesn't follow. In either cases you can show that it is a unsound argument. An argument could be sound in either of these two ways. For example, sometimes somebody convinces you with this kind of argument that it looks as if that, for example, a simple example which I already taken into consideration, all squares are, all circles are squares, all squares are circles, and all circles are parallelograms, all squares are circles, all squares are parallelograms. So that is the one which we discussed in the last few minutes. So if your friend comes and tells you this particular kind of thing, then you cannot question the validity of the argument. Now if I assume that the first two premises are true, then since it is a deductive argument, so it preserves the truth and all, there is no way in which all squares are parallelograms can be false and all. So that is a perfectly valid kind of argument. The only choice that you have is that you can show that the given argument is unsound and all by stating that one of your premises is false. Of course in this case both the premises are false and all. So in that way you can show that this particular argument, all circles are parallelograms and all squares are parallelograms, it's false, it's an unsound kind of argument. So there are situations in which you have a valid argument might have some kind of false premises and all. For example, if you say all logicians are millionaires and all, Kurt Gödel is an outstanding logician, that is a true statement. So Kurt Gödel is a logician, therefore Kurt Gödel has to be a millionaire. So this argument is a valid argument, but we all of us know that not all, actually if you verify the facts etc, historical facts etc, all logicians cannot be millionaires and all. If it is the case then well and good, but actually unfortunately it is not the case and all. So in this case this is a valid argument, but it is an unsound argument because you can very well show that all logicians are millionaires has this exception, at least on one instance where it is not the case. So its conclusion might not follow from the premises. For example, if you say all billionaires eat well and all, they have a lot of money, rich and etc and all, they eat well, overeating etc. For example, if Ravi eats well, just because Ravi eats well and all, he cannot come under the category that he is a billionaire and all. So this is a kind of invalid kind of argument. What I am trying to say is that in the first argument you can show that one of the premises is false, or the other way of showing that the argument is unsound is that, you know, the conclusion doesn't follow from the premises and all. That means you show that it is an invalid argument. All invalid arguments are automatically unsound arguments. So this is the connection between truth and validity. Just because you have true premises, that doesn't mean that the argument is valid and all. You can have true premises and true conclusion, but yet the argument may be invalid and all. So for validity, what is important is that if you accept the premises to be true, the conclusion cannot be false. So that means you are ruling out the possibility of invalidity and all. So an unsound argument you will come across in three different categories and all. In the first category, the argument is valid, but it has at least one false premise and all. It is one of the premises is false. So category 2 is that obviously it is an invalid argument, that means the conclusion doesn't follow from the premises, but all its premises may be true and all, not maybe, they are true and all. In category 3 it can be an invalid argument, but it has at least one false premise and all. So in either of these in these three categories we can show that the argument is unsound. First of all, invalid arguments are all automatically unsound and all. So that means invalid plus false premise. For example, there are some examples for this kind of thing. All trees are animals, of course that is a false proposition. All bears are animals, of course bears are animals only, that is a true statement. So if you say that all bears are trees and all, this is a very strange kind of conclusion that you are trying to come up with. First of all bears are trees, it doesn't follow from all trees are animals, all bears are animals. But you might ask why it is the case that, you know, it is not a valid kind of argument. But the best way of looking at it is by seeing the form of these arguments. All x or y, all this is like this particular kind of thing, just I will go into the details of it. All trees are animals, for example if you all x are y, so for example if you say that thing, x stands for trees and y stands for animals, trees and then this is animals, this is the first argument. And the second argument is all bears are animals, you know, so all Z. Z stands for base. All base are all Z's are animals and all. So this is Y. So now from this you are concluding that, what is that you are concluding? So all bears are trees, you know. All Z is considered to be bears and all are trees, that means X. So this is the one which we are trying to get come up with. So this is an invalid argument. The valid form of this one is this: all X are Y and all Y's are Z. Then you say that all X are Z. So if this is put in this particular kind of format, then it can be considered as a valid argument. You know. So this is clearly an invalid argument. Obviously, it is an unsound kind of argument. You know. Suppose if you transform it in such a way that come up with that particular kind of thing, the first one. This is the right kind of form. You know. This is obviously invalid and all. This is a valid kind of argument. You know. So you came across that particular kind of valid argument, but let us say one of the premises is false and all, then in that case the argument will become an unsound argument and all. So unsoundness arises in three different categories and all. So suppose if your friend presents you some kind of argument which are convincing and there is no way in which you can show that it is invalid kind of thing, that means the conclusion seems to be necessarily following from the premises. The only way in you can the only choice that you have is that you can show that one of the premises to be false and all. That is the only thing which you can do. The conclusion doesn't follow from the premises, although it is correct, or you can try to show that one or more premises are very uncertain and all. Of course, this is another way of saying that, you know, you make it uncertain in the sense that they are not 100% true and all, maybe true or maybe false, etc. and all. Then in that case, you are converting that argument into some kind of inductive argument and all. So it is in the sense that conclusion does not need not necessarily follow from the premises, but conclusion only probably follows from the premises and all. So that means conclusion only probably follows from the premises means you could come up with a counter example in which your premises are true, the conclusion is false. Even if you come up with one single instance, and that is good enough to say that the argument is invalid and all. Even if you suppose if you have 100 tomatoes and all, the tomato that you picked up is a rotten tomato, then that is good enough to show that the basket that the tomato it contains has rotten tomatoes and all. So here is an interesting kind of dilemma, I mean, which is slightly different from what we are trying to discuss and all. So this dilemma goes like this. This is a very important kind of problem which arises in the propositional logic in particular. So gradually we will go into the details of this particular kind of thing. So the story goes like this: a crocodile steals a son from his father, but the crocodile is a little bit kind enough or generous, he gives some kind of options and all. He will not just eat away son and all, but he promises to return the child. Suppose if he is asking his father to guess certain kinds of things and all, you guess whether I am going to return your child or not, that's what, you know. But the intention of a crocodile is either to eat or return the baby and all, a baby or kid here. So a crocodile steals a son from his father and promises to return the child if the father can correctly guess what the crocodile is going to do and all. Suppose if a crocodile intends to eat and all, if the father guesses that he is going to return the baby, so then he will, the father's guess is wrong, so he is not going to return the baby, so he will eat. Crocodile will simply eat the child and all. So if it goes against what the crocodile is intending to do, then the father's guess is obviously wrong and all, then he is not going to return the baby. So either the crocodile has two options and all, either he will eat or he will return the child and all. So if the father guesses correctly and all, that means it goes exactly in accordance with the intentions of the crocodile, then you will return the baby and all. Otherwise you will eat the baby. What happens if the father guesses that the child will not be returned to him and all. Suppose if that is the case and all, then what is going to happen? So for this particular kind of problem, this is a kind of unsolvable kind of problem and all, because there is no solution for this problem. If the crocodile keeps the child, then he violates his rule, because the father has predicted correctly and all. The rule that he has violated is he has to return the baby, but his actual intention is that he will so hungry and all, he will eat the baby and all. So since the father predicted correctly, he has to return the baby, but he has eaten the baby and all, so he cannot return. So that seems to be a problem. If the crocodile returns the child and all, then it still violates his rule in the sense that, you know, if you have predicted correctly, I will return the baby. If you predicted wrongly and all, I will eat the baby. So if the crocodile returns the child and all, then he still violates his rule, as father's prediction was wrong. If father's prediction was wrong, then he has to eat the baby, he cannot return the baby and all. So it's like some kind of paradoxical situation, or not, it's not a paradoxical situation, his crocodile is in some kind of dilemma, whether to eat or return the baby and all. So this problem gets unsolved, and this problem can be written in the formal terms like this. So this can be considered as a valid kind of argument and all, but one can show that it can be unsound, etc. So this problem is simply written as this thing: P implies Q and R implies S, then P R S, then it will be either Q or S. So it is like in the case of crocodile's dilemma, either to eat or return the baby is the one which is in some kind of dilemma. If he returns the baby, there is a problem, and if he eats the baby, then also he cannot return the baby. He cannot return the baby, then also there is a problem. So he is in a dilemma, what to do and all. So if the father's guess is correct, then he is going to return the baby, and if the father's guess is false, he is going to eat the baby. So now the father can only guess either true or false. There is no middle value between these things. It has to be true, it has to be false. His guess has to be correct, or his guess has to be false. If it goes exactly according to the intentions of the crocodile, then the guess is correct. Otherwise, suppose for example crocodile intend to eat and all, father says you are going to return the baby and all, so then it goes against that one, inconsistent with that one, so that is false. So now from this, so the crocodile has only so these two things. So this is seems to be a perfectly valid kind of argument and all. So this is what is crocodile has to say, and this is father, and then crocodile, and then father will respond in certain way. Suppose if you say he is not going to return the baby and all, so then it leads to it puts crocodile into some kind of dilemma. Actually crocodile is intent to eat the baby, so hungry and all. So now there is no solution in particular, in the sense that if the crocodile keeps the child, then he violates his rule, as the father predicted correctly and all. If father predicted correctly, then he has to return the baby, but he actually has eaten the baby. If the crocodile returns the child, and then that means he still violates his rule that father's prediction was wrong and all. So in this case, this problem gets unsolved and all. So we will stop here, and then we will move on to the strength of inductive arguments in the next class. So what we have simply said was this, that we started with different theories of truth, and then we talked about the relationship between truth and validity and all. It's not just enough that, you know, your premises are true, the conclusion just based on the premises are true, we cannot say that the argument is valid. So for the validity, what is important here is that if the premises are true, the conclusion cannot be false. So we will continue with the strength of the inductive arguments maybe in the next class. Thank you.
Thank you.